Am I audible to everyone? I was talking about his achievements here. Sir came up with the Bhasha Research and Publication Center, and he definitely writes in a number of languages, including Marathi, Gujarati, and English. He has also written and edited almost 90 books on literary criticism, anthropology, education, linguistics, and philosophy, and so on. If I name some of his books here, he has written The Being of Bhasha in 2014, Samvad, The Crisis Within, which is on knowledge and education in India, Trijya, The Question of Silence, and so on. Sir was also awarded with Padma Shri on 26 January 2014. He was also awarded Sahitya Academy Award in 1993. He was also given the reputed Prince Claus Award. And his Marathi book, Vanaprastha, received 8 awards, including the Durga Bhagwat Memorial Award and the Maharashtra Foundation Award. So I think there are so many achievements, and we can see that we have many dignitaries coming to Takshala platform and delivering knowledge and learnings to our students here. So today, sir, we'll be talking about the future of human society between the virtual and the real. May I please invite sir? Welcome, sir. Sir, am I audible, sir?
Yeah, I'm just, I'll be back in a moment.
Yeah, sure, sir.
Yeah. Thank you so much for this elaborate and very generous introduction. I'm very pleased to be speaking to you and the large number of students who are preparing to take reins of the society and the future in their hands. Just as when they look at me, an old man, they're curious to ask me questions about old times, the times of Homer's Odyssey and Iliad, and our own Ramayana and Mahabharata and history and Gandhi and Ambedkar. Just as that curiosity wells up in their minds, when I look at these young students, a different kind of curiosity comes to my mind. I want to ask them, what will the future be like them for them? And when that question comes to my mind, just as I'm keen to know from them what their idea of the future is, I also like to share with them what my idea of the future is them is. Therefore, I chosen this rather very unusual topic of the future of humans between the physical and the digital. We all know, and if we do not know, we need to know that the entire cosmos took birth out of a very strange incident, a kind of a cosmic explosion, the Big Bang. And that happened probably 14 billion years ago to come to the Indian counting system. It is about 1400 crores of years ago. And our solar system fell in place roughly 650 crores of years ago. The Earth took its shape approximately 450 to 400 crores of years ago. In this long history, the history of humans is relatively very short. The humans have been here for not more than about 2 million years. And that's not much time in the cosmic scheme of things. Is roughly 20 lakh years. And even of those 20 lakh years, their behavior as humans not just the physiognomy as humans, but their social behavior as humans, has been barely 3 to 4 lakh years old. And even of those 3 to 4 lakh years period, which is relatively very short in the cosmic scheme of things, humans have been speaking just for about 70 to 80,000 years. So here we are, a very young species, which has, for various reasons, for a combination of reasons, known best to the process of evolution and not so much known to us humans, we have acquired a centrality in the scheme of this cosmos. I hope my voice is reaching you, because I'm seeing some different messages on my screens. I'll continue. Yes. Madam, is my voice reaching you?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. So I'll continue. It is in the last 60 to 70,000 years since humans started speaking languages, probably a cultural acquisition and not so much a natural gift. I'm saying this because language is not given in the structure of the brain, but it is acquired socially through a very long process of training the organs which were not meant initially for speech. Organs such as lips, teeth, eyes, nose, and tongue. We have acquired this through a very long process of socializing and process of training these organs. Language made us a social animal, unlike other animals. An animal that can transact thoughts which emerge inside one's brain, are communicated by putting them out in an intangible form of sound and speech in such a way that they reach another person's brain and acquire once again a tangible form, a form of thought. And because humans acquired this peculiar gift of language and started transacting thought with the help of language, humans were able to generate thought and thought-based ideas or ideologies for taking the human society forward. We have come a long way from that time. And we are today poised at a juncture where the road ahead of us seems radically divided. One direction in which humans may move forward appears very bleak. Students may know that last year scientists gathered to take stock of where we stand in relation to the resources that we have, the natural resources we have, and came to the conclusion that the human footprint on nature, the carbon footprint on nature, has come to a stage from where we can never go back to a point from where we started. It is an irreversible process. Scientists agreed that we have crossed various tipping points. The tipping points are global warming, loss of biodiversity, loss also of cultural diversity, the thinning of the ozone layer in atmosphere, the rising of sea water and the melting of glaciers and melting of snow, stock at the polls. Since we have gone past all these tipping points, the scientists concluded that humans have entered a new age, a new era, which they have named Anthropocene. Anthropocene is the time where humans will definitely cause the destruction of the Mother Earth. They will leave it charred and inert, a lifeless, dead body, like many other planets and stars in the cosmos. They have concluded that this will eventually lead to the end of life, which emerged on the Earth approximately 250 crores of years ago. This is a sad news, a serious news, a news that must make us think. It appears that we are at a juncture when ahead of us lies only this road of destruction, of decline, loss of diversity. There is another road also that humans have thought of. In order to explain what that road ahead of us is, I must go a little back in history by about 40 or 50 years. In the 1960s, when discussion about how to measure, how to determine, how to define development was very active in international bodies, a Russian astronaut came up with the idea that instead of just mapping the physiognomical features, the anthropological features, it would be much better to actually look at the precise access to energy that an individual has. His idea was that development can be measured by finding out how much energy an individual can access. His definition was based on the observation that humans had been and have been all along migrating towards source of energy, either active energy or agents that can generate energy for humans. Taking that forward, a mathematician in the US decided to figure out what would be the maximum extent of energy accessible to humans in any time in future, however distant that time, that point of time may be. His name was Dyson. And so Dyson's model came up with the conclusion that if humans could access all the energy available to them, the quantum of energy available to every individual would be a trillion times higher than the energy accessed by any individual today in the world. He had suggested a kind of an artificial shell to be bound, constructed above the earth, enveloping the earth, held aloft with the help of a mesh, a wire network of light, which could be opened at the press of a trigger, just as you open television and shut television by using your remote control. So that shell also, Dyson shell, can be opened and shut by remote triggers. And if the shell is opened in such a way that all the energy that the sun sends to the earth can be trapped, and if that energy can be used, humans would be energy rich in such a way that travel not just on the earth, but outside the earth, in outside space, in the cosmos, may become possible. And humans will never have a shortage of natural resources, particularly energy-related resources. If man manages to traverse that path, the development would take humans to a stage where humans can almost become like gods. Just as in India's ancient mythology, there was Indra, or in the Greek mythology, there was Zeus. Humans might become like the future Indras or the future Zeus. And the name of our species, Homo sapiens, might then be changed and become Homo Deus. There's a lovely book that I'm showing to you by Yuval Noah Harari, Homo Deus. Please try and read this book to see what I'm saying about the future possibilities of development. So from Homo sapiens, we might become Homo Deus. Now, these two are completely divergent views of development of man in future. The pessimist might take the view that humans are going to leave the earth charred entirely and make it a dead planet, ending life or all forms of life. And the optimist might take a view that humans might become like gods with infinite amount of energy available to them, saving their labor, resulting in production that we have never visualized in the past, a mind-blowing speed and within the control of humans. These two are not just divergent views of our future, but they are dramatically, diametrically divergent. The two cannot be reconciled. There is a third and a more sober, a more balanced, a more rational view of the development of humans. Because humans are not just objects to be molded, to be guided by technology. Humans are also not just a mob, a group, a large group of people to be led by some ideas. Humans are not just a social animal. Humans are also a thinking animal, as I said at the beginning. And it is in the human ability to think that we can find clues to where humans may go in future. I'm going to spend the remaining time of this lecture on explaining how this thinking ability has come up, what we have done to that ability, and what that thinking ability will do to us humans deciding, shaping our future. So here I go. You and I today think that universities, colleges are natural institutions. We think that these institutions were necessary. At one time, societies had not thought of such institutions. But now all over the world, people know the importance of education and knowledge, and therefore these institutions are set up. This view is right in a very limited perspective. But if we take a larger perspective, this view looks somewhat naive, quite a lot childish. The reality is that in the past, when humans acquired the ability to speak and they started conversing among themselves, they were able to transact ideas and put out thought, as I mentioned earlier. This process of speech, speaking, communication, transaction of ideas, conveying thoughts, had an unintended result. The intention was to carry out communication. But in the process of carrying out communication, humans started producing ideas as objective. When thoughts are there in your mind or in my mind, they are subjective. They are inside your mind. They are inside your brain. They are inside my mind and brain. But when the two of us exchange ideas, then the idea acquires an existence outside your mind and brain, outside my mind and brain. And therefore, it becomes objective. Accumulation of such objective thoughts and ideas, such impersonal, non-personal thought and ideas, can be managed with the help of memory. I remember very clearly what I said yesterday, or maybe 5 years ago. I even remember what I had said 50 years ago. But if there are thousands of persons spread over 1,000 years, how would they remember all that was said by all of them? The management of those thoughts and ideas therefore become an overload for an individual's memory, the natural human memory. In order to find a method, a way out of this overloading of natural memory of individuals, in medieval times, some scholars, some scientists decided to classify these ideas and thoughts. And therefore, they said there are some ideas and thoughts related to plants, some are related to stars, some are related to natural objects, some are related to the mind, some are related to God. And they gave these different sets of ideas and thoughts different names. Today, we think of those sets in the name of disciplines or subjects such as philosophy, psychology, physics, chemistry, and so on. But even there, when ideas and thoughts go on accumulating, they continue to accumulate, and human memory becomes short of its capacity to remember everything, new devices are introduced. These are called mnemonics, that is, memory methods. Just as you might have heard in some ancient Indian books, an entire formula of chemistry could be remembered with one word, where every letter signified the beginning of a line, the next letter signifying the beginning of the next line, the next letter beginning of the yet another line. We have all done this for passing examinations, for we reduce memory load into simple knots, into simple compressed memory files, if you like to call that, if you like to describe that activity with this term, compressed memory files within the human brain. In the 17th century, scientists found that different areas of memory, remembered memory, had been using different methods, and method within one field was not reconcilable with method used in another field. For instance, the method used in mathematics, a science which deals with numbers, could not be reconciled with the method used in physics, which also is a science that deals with measurements such as weights, mass, velocity, and so on, atomic numbers, and so on. Therefore, the scientists decided to generate a single table which will bring together all the memory methods so far created in human history in different fields. And this great accomplishment goes to the credit of a man called Leibniz, a French-German thinker, who came up with the idea that all that is remembered by humans can be interpreted, can be marked, can be designated, can be presented in terms of a series of a combination of 0 and 1. And there can be an infinite weaving together of zeros and ones. There can be limitless, numberless such series available to humans. When he came up with this formula, it became possible for all disciplines to interpret their own memory methods, their own tables and formulas in terms of a universal formula. It is because this method allowed universal conversion of memory fields, universal conversion of different knowledge fields, that this knowledge came to be, this method came to be known as the foundation of universal knowledge. This method was absolutely a masterstroke, a complete miracle of human intelligence towards storing all memory of all human beings who lived in all eras of history, in all nations, all parts, all continents of the world. Today, this method is used by the machine called computer for constructing its memory languages, the artificial languages. Since this method was accepted during the last years of the 17th century and the beginning of the 18th century, and since a universal knowledge does not mean knowledge about the universe. Universal knowledge means knowledge based on this method, which can link you universally with any component of knowledge, provided you know your own area of knowledge and how to interpret, and you know how to interpret your own area of knowledge in terms of this universal formula. So since universal knowledge came up, the knowledge stock in the world multiplied, and it has today multiplied to such an extent that neurologists tell us, cognitive sciences tell us, experts of learning, experts in the field of education tell us that the human brain has started experiencing a great knowledge fatigue. You'll be surprised to hear this from me, but let me tell you that there is a very wonderful wonderfully gifted thinker, a man called Rossi, Paolo Rossi. I'm holding his book before you. He has written an excellent history of memory, how humans treated not individual memory, not your memory and my memory, but memory which is neither yours nor mine, the objective memory, memory outside you and me, memory in the collective space of human societies. So my comments are based on this book. And there is another scientist who is a leading cutting edge cognitive science thinker. Her name is Marin Wolf, and she's written this book called Proust and Squid. Do read it if you can. Marianne Wolf says that the left side of the brain, which is described as Broca's lobe, the Broca's half of the Broca is the person who described this part of the brain. So it is called Broca's lobe, which helps us analyzing linguistic signals, which helps us analyzing what we read, what we hear. It helps us in analyzing what we get through linguistic signals, and it helps us in arriving at judgment and abstraction. it processes all these signals and reduces them to knowledge that is within your mind or my mind. Marin Wolf says, after testing the brains of fresh learners for a very long time, that this part of the human brain has developed a fatigue, that it is no longer willing to work. If there are teachers among my audience today, they will agree that the number of books they used to read during their childhood was much higher than the number of books that children of today's generation read in their childhood. Because the human brain is tired of reading. You might suddenly ask me a question. You might ask me, does it mean that the human brain is becoming incapable of holding knowledge? The answer is not yes. The answer is the exact opposite. The answer is that the human brain is developing a new capacity, and that capacity is developed with the help of the prefrontal cortex, where knowledge is gathered through visual signal rather than linguistic or oral signal, not through the ear, but through the eye, not through word and language and sentence and grammar and paragraph and books, but through images. Humans today are learning how to open up a fantastically vast vista, vast canvas of knowledge, which can be presented with the help of images, which can be presented with the help of visuals. If the human brain is showing fatigue in Broca's law, the human brain is showing an excess activity, an accentuated activity, a great excitement in the prefrontal part of the brain. All this has been tested by cognitive sciences and neurologists, and on the basis of their observations, I'm trying to convey to you that the recursive mind that we had, the mind that produces thoughts, the mind that produces thoughts and presents those thoughts to the world in the form of linguistic presentation, is undergoing a great change. I am presenting yet another book by Corbalis. It's called The Recursive Mind. It was published 9 years back. And this book tells us that during the process of natural evolution, humans have arrived at a stage where humans will be using their brain in a much different way than they have used it so far in the past. If we accept these scientific observations, if we're willing to go along with scientific observations that I mentioned, then it follows that the society of humans in the future will be a society of a different kind. That society will not be so much interested in a three-dimensional, physical, tangible, material presence of humans, but a non-dimensional or a multi-dimensional image of humans as humans. Now, this may be slightly difficult for you to understand, but let me explain by giving some simple examples. Supposing today one of us falls ill and catches the coronavirus. It won't be enough for us to catch the coronavirus. It would also be necessary for us to enter the Health Setu or some such software in order to be known, to be registered, to be recognized as a corona virated person. If you are a citizen of a country and you're physically there, very much there, sitting under a tree for the last 10,000 years, but if you do not have your Aadhaar card, if you do not have a digital presence, then you still remain an incomplete citizen. The digital presence of humans is slowly entering our life, our society, our thought, our actions as a substantial presence and therefore a part of reality. Till now, all philosophies in the world defining reality have defined it as that which is there, which is out there, that for which there is evidence of being there. But in the virtual world, the out there is not, it cannot be, it shall never be confined in parameters of space and time. The out there, the digital world, has neither sense of time nor sense of space. Or one may say it has limitless times and limitless space. And in that digital world, space and time come together. Some of you might think that probably I am not speaking rationally, and therefore let me remind you that a man called Einstein, while describing the space outside the earth, had told us that in that space, space does not exist as pure space. Time does not exist as pure time. They become space-time combined. That is, space is at the same time time, and time is at the same, in the same space, space. I'll give an example. An example that might make this slightly easier. Wherever you are just now, please look up. Look at the roof of the house or the treetop or the sky if you are sitting outdoors. And imagine that there is a star. Imagine that star is about 500 light years away. And imagine that you are able to see that star. Now, when you see the star, a ray of light emanating from the star will have reached the pupils of your eyes. Can I ask you, would it be all right for me to ask you this question? When the light reaches your eyes, have you gone back in time by 500 years? Because the stars, the journey of the ray of that light, that ray of light started 500 years ago. Have you gone back in history by 500 years, or has the star come forward from its time to your time by 500 years? Now that question is an absurd question. In order to remove that absurdity, Einstein was saying that in the space between your eye and that star, our idea of space and our idea of time just make no sense. They do not exist. What exists there is a space-time continuum, a space and time twined together, bundled together. The future humans will succeed in spreading the realm of reality outside human space and time and into the realm where space and time are together, where no space is pure space and no time is pure time. in that world, humans will be more digital and less physical, as I said. There is a name for such a creature, and that name was given by an American thinker, Haraway. Haraway said that such an animal should be called cyborg, somebody who lives in the cyberspace, who is alive in the cyberspace. Cyborgs are likely to be people who do not depend entirely on natural intelligence, are people who depend more on artificial intelligence, AI, than on NI, natural intelligence. Their thought, mind, and heart, emotions, will be governed by a combine of AI and NI. It will be a new kind of a species. Ask me, do I really think that this is going to happen? My answer is, it is not my desire that this should happen. It is not my dream that this should happen. It is all these scientists who are talking about the recursive mind and the change in the brain structure and the future historians of future of memory and the philosophers who are talking about Homo Deus. They are predicting that the human society is going to change in a very fundamental way, in a big way, and the foundation of all knowledges will be completely different. There will be an epistemic change. An episteme is the building block of knowledge, just as you build a house with the help of bricks. Supposing instead of bricks, you are given another material. Instead of bricks, you are given, let's say, icebergs. How will you build a house? That house will have to be built differently. When you build a house on the banks of a river or seashore, the house made of sand, you build it differently. The building block of knowledges, fields of knowledge, various fields of knowledge, that building block had changed. If it has not changed in every field, it is bound to change in every field in a very short time, maybe another 5 years, 10 years, 15 years. And at that time, what is knowledge will be seen differently. At that time, the stockholders, the storage places, the cold storages of knowledge that we have known in the past will no longer be in existence. Or if they are in existence, they will function differently. Which are these cold storages of stockholders? They are the libraries, museums, schools, colleges, and universities. 10 years from now, we will not be able to see a university functioning the same way as universities have functioned over the last 200 years. A school which will function the same way as schools have functioned over the last 10 centuries. There will be a digital and a physical co-mingling of beings. Some citizens in nations will be digital citizens, entirely digital citizens. Citizens who perform the function as AI beings, artificial intelligence beings. Some who are cyborgs, a combination of natural intelligence and artificial intelligence, and others yet to follow, yet not merge with this changing shape of society. Imagine that when this happens, all the knowledge stock acquired by humans over the last 60 or 70,000 years since humans started speaking, or at least over the last 7,000 years since humans started writing in Egypt, the first writing emerged in Egypt 7,000 years before our time, or at least last 3,000 years since human philosophy started, all of that may have to be discarded. Values that we learned, values such as love, such as friendship, such as sharing, such as equality, such as freedom, we may lose those values. You will notice that as the new era of digital citizenship begins, democracies all over the world have become dictatorial. I mean, let's not feel shy of calling a spade a spade. I'm not talking of this party or that party. I'm talking of a much larger canvas, a global canvas. Democracies were won by nations through struggle, spread over 100 years. The entire 20th century was the century when nation after nation acquired democratic governments. And suddenly today, whether it is in Germany, in France, in the United States, Turkey, Russia, China, our own country, we see that what appeared to be democracy in the past has suddenly become dictatorial. We also notice that the state is doing a super surveillance of individuals to the extent that the state today knows the not just where you stay and which car or motorbike or bicycle you use. The state also knows what kind of dinner you would like to have in the evening. It knows about your moods, about your emotions and the thoughts inside your mind, not the objective thought, but the thought inside the brain. There is the era of super surveillance. There is the era of dictatorship. There is therefore the era of denial of equality and denial of freedom. In the future, as humans enter this new era of digital citizenship, new era of time-space continuum, new era of a view of the cosmos, which is entirely different from the view that we had earlier. We thought that there is one Akash Ganga, you know, and there is one Big Bang. But today, the view is this one galaxy is part of millions of other galaxies. And beyond those galaxies, there are cosmoses which operate along the physics of black matter, not our kind of physics, not where the Newton's apple necessarily has to fall down, but a different kind of physics, and the rules of physics operate there. We will be internalizing a large part of that cosmos in future. We shall become homo deus, as philosophers are telling us. But in the process, we shall be much less human. The values that we acquired as humans, the value of love, of sharing, of freedom and equality, we may lose. Therefore, it is necessary for us as we transit from this era to the future era. It is necessary for us, extremely necessary for us, I shall say, to take at least an iota of this with us in the future world. In the past, if something happened in the United States, we were not so much concerned. But today, if a white man insults a black man in the United States, it is necessary for us to feel concerned and necessary for us to protest. Because if we do not protest, the inequality which the new technology, new surveillance regime, new democracy-less state structure, the inequality being promoted by all these might become the order of the world. And in that unequal world, in the world suffocated by equality, not many will be able to breathe freely. While some might become like gods, most might be treated like animals. It is therefore necessary for us to move ahead in future as we move ahead in future, we must also move ahead as humans and carry forward to the future world what we acquired as humans, what is valuable. Not just the old stories of Puranas and the, not stories of Ramayana and Mahabharata and Vedas and Bible and Quran, and not the old identities, limiting identities as black or white, Muslim or Hindu or Jain or Jew or Christian. But the great ideas that, for instance, the French Revolution gave us, ideas that Gandhi gave us, we must carry forward. I think the future of humans in the digital world can be ensured only if we never forget that we are humans first, and therefore we are moving to the future. Thank you so much for your patience. Good day.
Thank you so much, sir. So shall we open this chat window? If students have any questions, we can address those questions.
A few questions, if you like, I'll entertain. Thank you.
Oh, okay, sir. Okay. Any questions, students here? If you would like to ask something from sir? I'm just receiving the compliments for you, sir. There are no questions coming as such.
I'm not surprised, because I was speaking of such unusual things. I doubt if, I wonder if there would be any questions.
Okay,
but,
okay.
Soumya, I think Soumya Ghosh wants to say something. So I'll wait. And there is Shivam Shukla also. And Priyanka and Narmada Meena.
Okay. Sir, actually Shivam is talking about, he's saying that you talked about the changing mind structure. So can you please elaborate something more on that? That's what Shivam Shukla is asking.
Well, all along, the brain has linked humans with the rest of the world by using linguistic symbols in addition to mere physical sensation. It is the left part of the brain. I am showing you the figure. Is it clear? Can you see it?
Yes.
Yeah. So it is the language, taking part. That is becoming now less because of overuse of that part. Because of overuse of that part, it is becoming less active. And it is the prefrontal cortex which is now becoming more active here. So that part of the brain allows us to perceive the world through visual images. All along we have seen the world and heard the world. But in the past, our knowledge of the world, knowledge about the world, our experience of the world has been more actively pursued on the basis of linguistic symbols. Less active, for instance, when you tell me that the apples in Kashmir were not so sweet this year because people in Kashmir were worried about many problems. I have not been to Kashmir and I have not seen an apple. And yet when you tell this to me, I am able to visualize, because language enables us to visualize absent things. We are today moving to a stage where rather than visualizing something that is absent through a symbol, a linguistic sign, we want to visualize it directly through a sign which is closer to it. This sudden explosion of cameras in the world is not without any reason, not just because the Japanese produce cheap cameras or Americans or Germans produce cheap cameras. It is, that is not the reason. humans do not use things unless they are strictly necessary for the process of evolution. Humans are extremely careful in what they use and what they do not use. Today, every child, just a two-year-old child, is also able to operate camera because the human brain is wired with the camera eye. Today, the way I am speaking to you is through the, earlier this was not possible. And this is not just the development in technology. This is development inside the human brain, because that is what the evolution is taking us to. This is the part of the evolutionary process of humans.
So if we talk about today's generation, I think they lack a lot of concentration and they really do this face this problem. And there are a number of philosophers around who have been talking about to increase the memory and to increase the concentration. So can you guide the students on this platform?
I saw flashed a question about how can we compete with artificial intelligence. Okay. I saw someone wrote that question. Mm-hmm. Right. Let me answer this.
Okay.
We as humans, whether Africans, Americans, Australians or Indians, are one kind of human being. Prior to this phase of mammals walking on 2 feet, there was also another variety of humans, and two varieties coexisted. Neanderthal was more intelligent, taller than us, and heftier. So humans with greater strength and greater intelligence perished, and we survived. We are the human variety with lesser intelligence and lesser strength. But we survived because we were sufficiently inventive. We invented fire. We invented the use of wheel. We invented methods of floating on water, that is by use of timber, wood. And it is because of that nearly 1,20,000 years ago, humans could go from Africa to Australia and they survived. I mean, I'm not saying that they had daily voyages from Africa to Australia. It must be a very, very difficult journey. The hundreds, thousands might have died in the process, but some survived. And so people survived in Australia, they survived in Europe, they came to India, they came to Andaman first, and they survived. And for the last 45,000 years, there have been human beings in this land, India. So our competition with artificial intelligence will depend on how innovative we are. Intelligence is not a substance. Intelligence is not just the memory capacity, like we have memory chips. Intelligence is an action, a process. So humans will have to be in the process of keeping the artificial intelligence in collaboration or under control. But the day artificial intelligence takes control of humans, then of course, for instance, it may happen at airports very soon, that some AI will actually allow us or disallow us entry, allow us or disallow us boarding the plane. It is the same AI which might fly planes. No longer human pilots will fly planes. There will be a huge server that will be flying planes. Why will humans risk their lives in flying planes? So we will have to have new laws, new structures of government, new methods of representing ourselves, voicing ourselves. And for that, we will need human to human understanding and harmony. Thank you.
Sir, they're also talking about, if we talk about the thought processes, They are so different from what people used to think in past and how people are thinking at present. So is there any way out to bridge the gap in the thinking processes? Because that results into a lot of conflict.
Yeah, madam, can you repeat your question? Because yes. Your voice did not come clearly to me. Yeah.
Students are saying that if we talk about the thought processes, they are too different when we talk about the past generation and today's generation. So is there any way out to bridge this gap so that there is no conflict?
See, there are in all approximately 85 billion neurons in the brain. And humans have not used a majority of those neurons effectively so far. So the infinite variety of what the brain can do is not even known to us. I mean, I'll give an example. When I was a child, this pain was given to me, not this pain, but some by my parents. And I knew how to use it. But I was not able to use it at that time like William Shakespeare used his pen. The same instrument has infinite variety. I think the thought that we have today, what we recognize as thought, is an assemblage of signals. I mean, if you were to subdivide a thought, assemblage of signals in a logical manner. That is, X is and therefore Y is. That's the logic. Or X is and therefore Y may be something. That is another. There's either deductive logic or inductive logic. In future, these billions of neurons will take us beyond logic and create for us new facilities of assembling ideas, experiences, perceptions, and intersubjectivity. And at that time, thought might be, just now I'm seeing on my screen name of a person as well as a symbol, which is like this. I think it's called smiley or whatever. I would not have recognized it about 10 years back, quite frankly. But today I recognize what it is saying. It is saying I have curiosity, I want to ask a question.
Yes.
So new ways of communication will come up, new ways of weaving thoughts together will come up. And in an existence where space can be transcended with greater ease, time can be transcended with greater ease, thoughts can be constructed differently, with much greater freedom. And there will, of course, be choice for us to respond to a thought or not to respond to a thought. Thank you.
So there is a very interesting question, and somebody is saying, but what do you think is the reason behind Einstein's intelligence? So that, you know, the students can also incorporate that and make themselves more competent.
Yeah, I will. There is one young friend has asked three times, what will be the world like 10 or 15 years from now? Yes. And I'll briefly answer that. I'm not an astrologer, and I do not like to predict what it will be, but I can sense that the young generation of today will have, in the next 10 to 15 years, alerted the world to the danger of loss of freedom. In the next 10 years, the world will very forcefully, energetically move towards a new idea of freedom. It will be a world without dictatorships. That will be the future of the world. Because all trends in psychology, in philosophy, in economics indicate that people are asking for opening up, not closing down, not shutting down, but opening up. And if I read the signs of time correctly, it is going to be an era of new freedom, new kind of freedom.
And sir, as far as the intelligence is concerned, how would you really guide them so that they develop on intelligence and their competencies? And plus, how can they be really powerful as far as the values and ethics are concerned?
Well, AI, you know, artificial intelligence is coming to us not like rains come to us. AI is not going to fall from the skies. We are going to develop. Humans are going to develop. But it is a fact that humans have been selfish animals. Humans have been a selfish animal. And therefore, those who have control of things would want to use artificial intelligence for controlling things. I mean, I will give you an example. As soon as this corona-related lockdown started, and many colleges and universities had to figure out ways of examining new methods of examination, they chose not your university. I'm speaking of other universities. They chose a software by using which students could write examinations from home. But this software was hugely invasive. The software allowed the supervisor to see if the student was changing the pajamas or, you know, going and washing hands at the wash basin in the house. This invasion is not actually part of the educational process, nor necessary. Those universities, I mean, some universities were consulting me on this. They were asking me. I said, why are you restricting the students' freedom? Why are you so suspicious of them? Why do you think that they will necessarily copy? Are all of them thieves? Or have they come to learn? I believe that they come to learn. When they copy and they steal, that means it is the fault of my fraternity. I am not able to make knowledge sufficiently interesting. So those who have power, those who are in commanding position, will use artificial intelligence to control the rest of the society. It is for the rest of the society to come together, unite, and throw off that kind of control. So AI, the battle is not going to be between the artificial intelligence and humans. The battle is going to be triggered by use of artificial intelligence by the powerful people in the world against the less powerful people in the world. The battle will be between the less powerful and the more powerful in the world, which is triggered just as knowledge, the British knowledge used for promoting colonialism triggered such battles between the powerful and the less powerful. Capitalism triggered battle between the powerful and the less. Religion triggered battles between the powerful and less powerful. AI is the new version of religion, colonialism, and capital. AI is the new version. So it is the less powerful who will have to unite and fight for their rights and be on the right side of history. Thank you.
So do we have any more questions? I think, sir, you have answered, and your session itself was explanatory, self-explanatory in nature. So I think that has answered all the questions. So I think that's a time to conclude here.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Have a good day. Good
thank
lunch.
Thank you so much, sir.
Okay, bye-bye. Thank you. I switch off. Bye.